The laws concerning accidents and the civil responsibility to not harm others are the body of laws known as tort law. Examples of torts are car accidents, someone getting injured by diving into a shallow pool, an accident due to an improperly manufactured ladder, or medical malpractice. The economic purpose of tort liability is to induce insurers and victims to internalize the cost of harm that can occur from failing to take care. We want to use tort law to give insurers and victims incentives to take the optimal amount of precaution. When it comes to the optimal amount of precaution, is it possible to be too careful? Often public policy governing consumers and occupational safety feeds on the emotion of the value of saving a human life. Some claim if it saves a life, it is always worth it. Is this the principle you use to govern your own life? None of us are conducting our lives in such a way that the probability that you die in an accident is zero. We all face the positive probability of death. Can you think of steps that you could take to decrease the probability that you die in an accident? It is probably pretty easy to come up with a list of things you could do to decrease the probability of an accident. Personally, I could stop rock climbing. I could shorten my commute by moving closer to work. I could stop biking. Perhaps you could sell your vintage set of lawn darts. They actually have been banned in the US and Canada for safety reasons. We can think of all sorts of things we can do to make ourselves safer, but we do not take the steps. Why is that? When I ask this question in class, students are quick to point out because the costs outweigh the benefits of increased safety. Apparently, you don't think that your own life has infinite value. At least you do not act like you do. Similarly, when it comes to policy and law, many steps to improve safety may have costs that outweigh the benefits. We can use a familiar graph to model the optimal amount of risky behavior. Let's suppose we are talking about lawn darts. Each hour you play, you incur an expected cost due to the danger of the game. Your private costs are represented by the marginal cost curve labeled MC. The marginal benefit curve shows the marginal benefit you get from playing lawn darts. The more you play, the less marginal benefit you get from an additional hour. You will choose QC as the optimal amount of time you play. The problem is the marginal cost curve here does not represent all the costs of playing lawn darts. You usually play with other friends, and you joining the game increases the probability that one of them is hurt. There is an external cost of you playing lawn darts. In other words, you are causing a negative externality. The actual marginal cost of you playing lawn darts includes the cost to you and the cost you impose on others. The true optimum is Q star, which is less than QC. Our goal with tort law is for you to internalize the externality you impose on others. In the case of lawn darts, we also want the friends that you are playing with to appropriately weigh the costs they impose on others. Notice this graph does not suggest that the optimal amount of risky behavior is zero. However, if you do not have something like tort law giving you the incentive to consider the costs that you impose on others, you are likely to spend too much time playing lawn darts. Tort law fills a gap left by property law and contract law due to high transaction costs. In the example of you playing lawn darts with your friends, you can imagine using a contract to give everyone the incentive to consider the negative externalities they impose on others. Perhaps the contract requires the insurer to make any victims whole. The problem is transaction costs are high enough that we usually do not see contracts for these sorts of events. The probability of an accident is too low, the costs of drafting a contract are too high. After the injury, transaction costs may be too high to get a settlement without tort law too. For one reason, there is often a significant amount of acrimony among the parties that coming to an agreement is difficult. Acrimony increases transaction costs. In many product manufacturing cases, you could imagine a warranty, which is a type of contract, helping manufacturers to internalize external costs from manufacturing mistakes. However, writing a warranty covering many low probability events may be expensive and may unnecessarily scare consumers away. So due to high transaction costs, we are not likely to create the incentives for people to take the optimal amount of precaution using contracts or property law. There are three elements necessary to assign liability under the traditional theory of torts. 1. The plaintiff must have suffered harm. 2. The defendant's act or failure to act must cause the harm. And 3. The defendant's act or failure to act must constitute a breach of duty owed to the plaintiff. So in summary, the three elements are harm, cause, and breach of duty. To understand what we mean by harm, consider the following. U1 represents Anne's level of utility before an accident. Recall that utility is a measure of well-being or satisfaction. Here we assume that Anne's utility is a function of health and wealth. any point along the indifference curve labeled U1 is a combination of health and wealth that yields the same level of utility, U1. Initially, Anne has the combination of health and wealth, H1 and W1. After an accident, Anne's health declines from H1 to H2. So Anne moves to a lower level of utility represented by indifference curve U2. We assume here that Anne's accident did not affect her wealth. Our model suggests that if Anne is given enough additional wealth, that it is possible for her to return to the pre-accident level of utility, even if she does not recover her health. If her wealth is increased to W2, she will be back to the original level of utility. So if Anne is given damages equal to the difference between W2 and W1, she will be made whole. Suppose you go bungee jumping and have a great experience. However, when the very next jumper jumps, the bungee cord breaks and the jumper dies. It is 100% obvious that you had just jumped using a defective bungee cord. You feel lucky to be alive. Will a court award you damages if you sue the company providing the bungee jumping experience? No, because there was no actual harm done. The second element is cause. Without causation, the plaintiff is not liable for the harm. One tool sometimes used to establish causation is the logical tool cause and fact. Here we ask, but for A, would B have occurred? If the answer is no, then A caused B. If the answer is yes, then A did not cause B. Sometimes cause and fact logic does not produce good incentives and thus does not make good economic sense. In David Friedman's book, Law's Order, he gives an example of a real court case that resulted from a tree falling on a moving trolley. Passengers were injured in the accident. The driver had been driving over the speed limit when the accident occurred, so the passengers sued. The court ruled in favor of the defendant, or in other words, the driver. Did the court do the right thing? Cause and fact logic would suggest the court did the wrong thing. However, from an economic perspective, the court did the right thing. Based on cause and fact logic, the speed limit violation was the cause. But for driving over the speed limit, would the tree have fallen on the trolley? The answer to this question is no. So cause and fact logic suggests the driver driving over the speed limit caused the accident. Economically, the court did the right thing. Here the question is one of incentives. Ex ante or before the accident, was there any reason to believe that driving over the speed limit would change the probability that a tree would fall on the trolley? No. In fact, if the driver had driven faster, the tree would have fallen after the trolley moved through the area. So ex ante, the driver's decision to drive over the speed limit did not increase the probability of a tree falling on the trolley. Ex ante, it did not impose any additional cost. It was entirely unforeseeable. Since the driver's decision to drive fast imposed no ex ante cost, imposing no liability gives the right incentives. Here's another example. Suppose you stop your best friend to talk after a chance meeting while walking down the street. After visiting for about 5 minutes, your friend continues down the sidewalk where he is crushed by a piano that was being moved through a fourth-story window. Based on cause and fact logic, did you cause your friend's death? Yep, you did it. But for stopping your friend on the street, would he have been crushed by a falling piano? No, he would not have been. However, from an economic perspective, should you be held liable? No. Holding you liable would not create good incentives because ex ante, you stopping your friend to talk did not change the probability of the accident occurring. You did not impose any ex ante costs on your friend. The final element required to assign liability under the traditional theory of tort liability is breach of duty. People have a duty to one another to avoid harming others. We must take proper precaution. Here are some examples of potential breach of duty. A driver not stopping at a red light, a pool owner not marking pool depths, a boat owner not keeping her boat outfitted with up-to-date life jackets and a fire extinguisher, a rock climber not retying her rope as recommended by the manufacturer, a doctor not washing her hands. As an example of tort liability, check out this episode of Seinfeld. You should be able to identify all elements of traditional tort liability being used by Kramer's lawyer.
So, you know, my friend and I, we were going to the movies, and we stopped off and bought this cafe latte.
Mm-hmm. What is that, like Italian coffee?
Yeah, that's right.
Half milk, half coffee?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You take a sip?
Yes, I did.
Now, when you took a sip, did you notice it was hot? Were you able to sip it in your normal fashion?
No, I wasn't able to sip it in my normal fashion.
Mm-hmm. All right, all right. You take big sips?
Well, I think I take a normal sip.
Okay, you take normal sips. Nothing wrong with that. Then what happened?
Well, you know, They don't allow outside drinks in the movie theater, so I had to put it in my shirt and sneak it in.
Yeah, see, they like to sell their own coffee.
Yeah. Now, is that going to be a problem?
Yeah, it's going to be a problem. It's going to be a problem for them. This is a clear violation of your rights as a consumer. It's an infringement on your constitutional rights. It's outrageous, egregious, preposterous.
It's definitely preposterous.
So, Ben, what happened?
Well, I was trying to get to my seat, and I had to step over someone, and I kind of got pushed, and it spilt on me.
Was there a top on it?
Yeah.
Did you put the top on, or did they put the top on
no,
for you?
They put the top on.
And they made the top. You didn't make the top, did you? Susan, I want you to go down to Java World. Get me a cafe latte with a top. We're going to run some tests on that top.
Whoa.
Have you been to the doctor?
No, I haven't.
Susie, call Dr. Bison. Set up an appointment for Mr. Kramer here. Tell him it's for me.
So, what do you think, Mr. Charles?
Jackie.
Jackie, I mean, we got a chance?
Do we have a chance? You get me one coffee drinker on that jury, you're gonna walk out of there a rich man.
I just came from a meeting with my lawyer.
Oh, yeah? How's that looking?
Oh, I'll tell you how it's looking. My lawyer, Jackie, says if there's one coffee drinker on that jury,
I'm gonna be a rich man! You put the bomb on? Who told you to put the bomb on? I didn't tell you to put the bomb on. Why'd you put the bomb on? You haven't even been to see the doctor. If you're gonna put a bomb on, let a doctor put a bomb on.
I guess I screwed up, huh, Jackie?
You damn right you screwed up. Where the hell did you get that damn bomb anyway?
The maestro.
The who? What are you talking about, maestro?
My friend, he's a conductor.
Oh, so a maestro tells you to put a bomb on and you do it?
Well, my stomach was burning.
I'll tell you what this is. This is a public humiliation.
Well, I didn't know the bomb was gonna work.
Do you know what a bomb is? You ever seen a bomb? Didn't you read the instructions?
Well, I was...
No one can tell what a bomb's gonna do. They're unpredictable.
But I'm sorry, Jackie.
Pull over here, driver. This is it.
Yeah. Get it.
I say we offer him $50,000. That's it. Take it or leave it.
How do we know how severe the burns are? Why don't we have him examined by a doctor?
Listen, the faster we dispose of this, the better. This thing gets into the paper, it'll kill us.
All right, we'll start with $50,000 and free coffee at all of our stores. Yes?
Mr. Childs and Mr. Kramer are here.
Send them in. Gentlemen. Gentlemen, come in. Now, we don't want to take up much of your time. Let's make this short and sweet.
Eh?
We're prepared to offer you all the free coffee you want at any of our stores throughout North America and Europe. Plus,
I'll take it!
I'll take it! I'll take it! Who told you to take it? Did I tell you to take it?
No.
I know the maestro didn't tell you to take it. He wasn't there.
Well, I thought we were lucky to get anything.
Free coffee?
Yeah.
I don't want free coffee. It's not hard to get coffee. I can get my own damn coffee. I wanted to hear what came after that plus.
Well, I didn't hear any plus.
20 years practicing law, I've never experienced anything like this.
Look, Java World. Hey, listen, I'm going to get out here and get myself a free cafe latte.